Hey guys, my name is Abhishek and welcome back to MBBS Treasure Channel. In this lecture, I am going to discuss about traumatic shock. In my previous video, I have already defined what is shock and what are its classification with its mechanism of action. In this video, I am going to specifically describe what is traumatic shock. It has two phases and how its mechanisms occur. And this topic is going to help you in CROC because most of the questions framed from this are its mechanisms. So you have to learn it thoroughly. Nextly, this traumatic shock question is the favorite question of many teachers in pathology. Okay, so I want you to kindly watch this video till the end. Okay, so without wasting time, let's start our today's video about traumatic shock. We are going to discuss about traumatic shock. In my previous video, I have already explained all about shock. If you haven't watched that, please go to my playlist of pathophysiology and there we will find it. Okay. In traumatic shock, what will happen? There will be a certain kind of injury to our own body or trauma, that is mechanical trauma or accident, that will be leading to a condition or critical extremal condition that is known as shock. What does that shock occurs? It will decrease the blood pressure acutely. There will be suddenly decreasing of the blood pressure that will result in or that will affect our body. So how the traumatic shock occurs and what are its two phases? Let's see. It has stages of shock, like it has two phases. First phase is the erectile phase and second phase is the torpid phase. Before we are going to understand this, I am going to make you think of situations like if this is a bus, okay, if this is a bus and in front of him there is a cycle, okay. What will happen if this bus will come at a very high speed and it will collide with this cycle, then what will be the next situation of this cycle? This cycle will tend to move in high speed. First, it will tend to move in high speed. Then what will happen if there is something like a tree or anything, then it will collide with that tree and lose all its motion. Okay, so just think of this situation. If a moving bus going with a very high speed will collide with a bicycle, then what will happen? At the very next situation, the cycle will tend to move at a very high speed. Then after it will collide with certain substance or it will lose its balance and the motion will be stopped. This is the same way situation happens to our own body during a kind of trauma or any kind of accident on us. So this thing will help you in remembering the total mechanisms. Now let's see. In the stages of shock, first stage is the erectile phase and second stage is the torpid phase. In the first phase, what will happen? This erectile phase is very short span of time. It occurs for a very short span of time. And in that very short span, there will be excitation of central nervous system. Our central nervous system will be excited, and in the result, to result of this excitation, there will be increasing in heart rate plus increasing in breathing. Okay. So you can consider this erectile phase to be the first situation where the cycle was moving very fast after the collision of the bus. Then what happens in the torpid phase? It acts for a very long span of time. It will act for a long period. Then what will happen? Decreasing in the excitation or sorry, inhibition of central nervous system, that will result in exactly the opposite of heart rate and decreasing of breathing, and blood pressure will down. So if this was the bus, this was colliding with the cycle, okay, then for the very first moment it was at high speed and then it collided with a tree. So this is going to be the erectile phase, and this phase is going to be torpid phase. In erectile phase, what happens? There will be excitation of central nervous system of our body. In response to that, there will be increasing of heart rate and increasing of breathing. So our reflex acts very fast in this period, erectile phase, and that is the erectile phase is the first stage of the shock. Then after what happens, the torpid phase comes and it lasts for a very long period of time. That inhibits the central nervous system, and that will result the finally the mechanism of the shock, that is, there will be decreasing in the heart rate, there will be decreasing in the blood pressure, that will lead to hypotension, and the rest we all know. Okay, so this is the basic thing that happens in the stages of the shock. In next, we are going to read about how this excitation of central nervous system going to result the increasing in the heart rate or breathing. So next, if we are going to plot this same situation or the stages of shock in a graph, then how we are going to see the graph? If this is a graph, okay, where y-axis is the CNS excitation and x-axis represents the time period, then how you are going to see the graph of the traumatic shock stages? First, initially, before the incident occurred, it will be in a certain completely undisturbed situation where the CNS acts normally. Then what happens? If there will be any kind of trauma or accident, it will tend to increase, but it will increase for a very short span of time, like this. If this acts for a very short span of time, this is the time of initial erectile phase, then what happens? Slowly it will decrease to zero, means excitation of central nervous system will decrease, then finally it will inhibit the central nervous system like this. So it acts for a very long period of time, and this phase represents to torpid phase, and this phase represents to erectile phase. So nextly, we are going to discuss the mechanism of the erectile phase. Initially, there will be a severe injury. There will be a severe tissue injury, and that will cause the pain sensation. The pain sensation is nothing but it will be afferent, means it will be going towards the central nervous system, and it will be that excessive, or it will be so excessive that it will cause the excitation of central nervous system. The excitation of central nervous systems, like firstly, there will be excitation of reticular formation in the central nervous system, and secondly, hypothalamus. These two structures will be excited along with other excitation of central nervous systems, and these two will result in, if there will be excitation of reticular formations, there will be hyperactivity of motor systems, and the person tends to speak a lot in spite of severe injury, the person tends to speak a lot, or there will be increasing in the motor system, motor activity. Okay, and in hypothalamus, what will happen? there will be activation of the endocrine system. As hypothalamus is the most regulating center of the pituitary gland or hypophyseal system and also the endocrine system, so after activation of hypothalamus there will be activation of the endocrine system, and most importantly there will be activation of two endocrine systems, that is, firstly there will be activation of the sympathoadrenal system and secondly the hypothalamo-hypophyseal system. Sympathoadrenal system, what will happen, the sympathetic, as it's a condition of totally sympathetic condition, and so it will further activate the adrenal gland that will help in releasing of the catecholamines, and it will happen suddenly, and there will be increasing of the catecholamines like adrenaline and noradrenaline. In hypothalamo-hypophyseal system, what will happen, the hypothalamus, as it regulates the hypophysis, means the pituitary gland, through the hypothalamo-hypophyseal tract, it means the hypothalamus regulates directly the posterior pituitary, because the hypothalamus mostly secretes the hormones like antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin, and other one is the oxytocin, and that's stored in the hypophysis, in the posterior hypophysis. So in this condition, after the activation of the endocrine system, there will be increasing in the secretion of the vasopressin, or otherwise known as antidiuretic hormone. Why this occurs in this situation? Because the vasopressin, it has two main functions, like first one is the vasoconstriction and second one is the retention of water. Vasoconstriction occurs in blood vessels through V1 receptors of vasopressin, because the V1 receptors are present in the blood vessels and that will in future lead to vasoconstriction, and secondly the V2 receptors, vasopressin 2 receptors, are present in the kidney and that will help in retention of water. Why retention of water? To maintain the equilibrium of hemodynamics. This is the compensatory mechanism of our body. So all this total, what we are saying, this is nothing but this is in compensation to the shock. That is the reason why it is the first phase of shock. Okay. Next, in the sympathoadrenal system, there will be increasing in the catecholamines from the adrenal cortex, from the adrenal medulla, and there will be increasing in adrenaline, noradrenaline, as adrenaline and noradrenaline will stimulate the adrenoreceptors in our body. There are beta adrenoreceptors in the heart and alpha adrenoreceptors in the peripheral blood vessels. So what will be the result? This will be the result in the peripheral vasoconstriction in the peripheral capillaries or the blood vessels, and secondly the beta 1 will be stimulated that are present in the heart, that will result in increasing in the heart rate, increasing in the minute heart volume, and finally as the heart is getting stimulated, so overall blood supply to the vitally important organs at the very intense situation like heart and brain will be increased. So blood supply to heart and brain are increased. This is nothing but called as blood circulation centralization. So in Kroc, what is the basic important questions asked is that, what is the phase of the traumatic shock that leads to the excitation of central nervous system? Answer is erectile phase. And second question comes that, in which phase the mechanisms of the blood circulation centralization is seen? So you have to remember that initially, in compensation to the shock, this very steps occurs, and it occurs for very short span of time. As I have said earlier, it occurs for very short span of time in response or in to compensate the loss of the body fluids from our body during any kind of mechanical trauma or accident. So this stage, erectile phase, occurs for a very short span of time, and where there will be excitation of central nervous system. Okay. So next we are going to discuss the mechanism of torpid phase. Till now, we have understood what is centralization of blood circulation that occurs due to overexcitation of central nervous system or subcortical or cerebral cortex formations like reticular formations and also hypothalamus. So the overall excitations of the central nervous system leads to the patient causing like hyperactivity of motor systems or highly speaking activity. So all this occurs due to the overexcitation of central nervous system. Till now we have read this much. Then what happens due to the centralization of blood circulation? What happens? The obviously as the blood is supplied more to the cells, the metabolism will also increase. As the metabolism increases, there will be increasing in the products of metabolism. That increasing in the production of metabolism or formation leads to congestion in the capillaries and veins, and that produces a situation called as toxemia. So we are going to deal with these three situations like toxemia, hypoxia and inflammations, which occurs or which is a characteristic features of the torpid phase resulting in decreasing in the excitation of central nervous system. Okay, so first, toxemia, how it occurs due to congestion of highly produced metabolism factors in the capillaries and veins. Then what happens? Hypoxia, how hypoxia? As the blood is not reaching sufficiently to all organs, concentrate on this thing, to all organs, it means it is only reaching to vitally important organs to survive, but it is not reaching to all organs. Like we have other organs, it needs blood for functioning its normal metabolic activities. So due to that condition, hypoxia arises. And thirdly, what happens? The inflammation at the site of injury. Obviously, if there is tissue injury, there will be inflammation, and that inflammation occurs due to these biologically active substances, and they are like histamine, prostaglandins and kinins. Of course, at the situation, if this is these three factors are not managed, then it is going to worsen. The shock situation is going to worsen. What happens next? This secreted things will get accumulated, and this increasing in the accumulation will lead to decreasing in the excitation of central nervous system. Plus, there will be disorder in the microcirculation, or there will be change in the rheological properties of the blood. How? Because the biologically active substances that are produced like histamine, prostaglandins, this histamine will increase the vessel permeability, and that vessel, due to increasing of the vessel permeability, it will lead to formation of tissue edema, and this thing will occur, then tissue edema will occur, and then what will happen? Sludge phenomenon. What is sludge phenomenon? There will be accumulation of blood forming cell. As the blood is lost during the trauma, so obviously to compensate, the blood forming cells will get accumulated at the site of injury, tissue injury. Okay, next, there will be microthrombi formation. There will be the platelets will do their function at the site of injury to make the microthrombi. So all these things will result in disorder of microcirculation or change in rheological properties of the blood. Then what happens? As the blood properties are changed and the blood viscosity changes due to this accumulation or congestion, so the blood is not flowing in the manner it should. So mostly the blood get accumulated in veins. The blood pool are found in veins, and then what will happen? As the blood will get accumulated in vein, so the right atrium will not get enough amount of blood to function properly from the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. That is what it said as decreasing in the preload. So from this condition, we know the mechanism of action of shock. Here there will be disturbance of cardiovascular system. So our cardiovascular system will decrease due to the decreasing in the preload condition. And finally, what will happen as the heart is disturbed? So there will be decreasing in the heart rate, cardiac output, stroke volume, and hypotension, decreasing in the tissue perfusion. All these things will lead to the multi-organ dysfunction. So this is how the torpid phase of traumatic shock concludes, with the same conclusion as we studied before in different varieties of shock. Okay, like concluding with the multi-organ dysfunction. So so it is necessary for a doctor to prevent all these kinds of situation at very important, intense, critical situation of the patient. It is necessary to understand these whole mechanisms completely so we can save a patient. So this was all about today's topic. We covered today the two phases of traumatic shock, and I hope it was helpful for you. And if you like, please then do subscribe my channel, and please support by commenting in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching my video.